Nandana Braja Janarandana Yashoda Nandana Braja Janarandana Yamuna Teeravana Chari Yamuna Teeravana Chari Jayo Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari Jayo Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama. Jayo Prabhupada, 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 Jayo Prabhupada. Nitai Gaur Hari Bol, Hari Bol. Hari bol nitai gaur hari bol
Jayam Vishnu Pada Paramahamsa Parivrajaka Acharya Ashrotara Shishimat Abhaycharna Aravinda Bhakti Vedanta Swami Shprabhupada Ki Samaveda Gaur Bhaktarinda Ki Nitai Gaur Premanande, all Gurus assemble devotees, all Gurus assemble devotees, all Gurus assemble devotees, all Gurus assemble devotees, Shishi Guru and Gauranga Ki. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya Om Ajnanati Mirandasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshuron Militam Yena
Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Shri Chaitanya Manobhishtam Sthapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamayam Dadati Swapadantikam Vandeham Shri Guru Shri Yutapadakamalam Shri Gurun Vaishnavamsha Shri Rupam Sagrajatam Sahagana Raghunathanvitam Tam Sajivam Sadvaitam Savadutam Parijana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padan Agana Lalita Shri Vishakhanvitamsha He Krishna Karuna Sindhu Dina Bandhu Jagatpate Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namosude Tapta Kanchana Gaurangi Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Vrishabhanu Sude Devi Pranamami Hari Priye Vancha Kalpataru Bhyasha Kripa Sindhu Bhyayevacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhar Shivasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare 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 Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare
Hare Krishna, we welcome all the devotees and those who have come for the first time for our Temple Sunday Feast program. This is the format that Srila Prabhupada started way back in 1960s when he first time in the New York when this con was established. So there used to be a love feast in the afternoons and Prabhupada made that into a Sunday love feast and then love became silent. Now it is mainly known as Sunday feast. And apparently seems to be it's all about prasadam, Sunday feast. But not just a feast for the tongue, but also feast for the eyes by looking at the beautiful forms, nicely, gorgeously dressed by our devotees. And feast for the ears. To hear those essential messages that will nourish us, that will enlighten us, and that will help us to lead our life in a much more meaningful and happy way. I would like to take just one word answer from different devotees maybe. You have a mic? So I won't take many, maybe two from the Prabhuji's, two from the Mataji's. What is the most important need we have? Food, clothing and shelter. Okay, anything else? Peace. Okay, two done. Mataji's? Love. Oxygen. You said something that will suffocate us if you don't agree with oxygen. Status and caliber. So we'll, of course, each one can come, will have definitely different things to come up with. What is the most important need that we all have. And in today's discussion, I want to focus on one particular need that we all have, and that how we can fulfill it in our lives and in interacting with others, and how ISKCON and Srila Prabhupada's books, the Bhagavad Gita and Srimad Bhagavatam, how they are designed or how they have been made available specifically to make this field need fulfilled. So they say the most important need of the human heart, apart from food, clothing, shelter, apart from status, apart from oxygen and love, is the need to be understood. That koi to mujhe samjhe. And this often isolates people, even within a family, because they are not able to understand the situation or the difficulties or the dilemma that the child is going through. Or in the ashram, they're not able to understand what that particular devotee is going through. And the best way that we try to express ourselves, or we try to make ourselves understandable to others, is through our words that we convey. When we go to a doctor, when we go to the waiter in Govinda's or any hotel, he doesn't understand hamare man mein kya chal raha hai. Of course, if the waiter understands our mind, he will not get anything, because we are too confused which one to order. All the options are going on. The equation, how to have best with the best pricing also. And so in today's session, I want to take this topic of the art of listening. That all of us are very interested to speak, maybe including myself, I'm speaking here. But, and there are so many seminars in the world outside, how you can speak effectively, how you can market your product, your idea, your opinion to others in the best possible way. And everybody wants to speak out, be at the forefront. But equally important is the other art, is the art of receiving, is the art of listening. Because if you don't understand what the other person is going through, how can you really give what you want to give? And these ears that Krishna has given us is a very, very important organ in our whole human biology, that it is the first organ that is activated when we are born, and that's the last organ which is deactivated or stops functioning when we are dead. Therefore, they say that even when a person is in coma, he can still hear. Therefore, those who are around a person who is in coma, don't start talking ill about that person or start making other plans. Badrinarayan Maharaj, he speaks this story that in San Diego, in a hospital, one man was in coma for around 8-9 months. After he came out of the coma, he immediately divorced his wife and he married the nurse. I think we forgot to make the announcement. Please keep your mobiles on silent mode. And the reason was because when this guy was in coma, the wife was apparently flirting with the doctor, because she was looking, where is my next opportune? Where can I be placed best next? But the nurse, maybe out of payment, maybe out of the training she has or of character, she was sincerely serving the patient. So this year is very important, that event for our functioning of the human body, that many things we start to learn by hearing, when we go to a teacher, when we go to others, through hearing. And one of the main qualifications that Srila Prabhupada had, that his guru, Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur, very much appreciated, was that he likes to hear. And so even whether it be for material growth or spiritual growth, this art of listening, this ability to listen, fully being there and grasping the subject matter, is very, very important. And therefore, amidst relationships, one of the very important thing is if we are able to understand and spend time hearing. And even in the Bhagavad Gita, the first chapter of the Gita, Krishna doesn't speak at all. Krishna is just sitting there and hearing Arjuna's all types of reasons why he doesn't want to fight. He could have cut Arjuna immediately when there were five reasons why Arjuna didn't want to fight. As soon as Krishna finished first reason, he could immediately cut him there and reply. That's what they say, that many times when we are hearing someone else, instead of trying to understand, we are thinking, what should I reply? Ki ab isko reply kya do? Or how can I give the excuse to run away from here? Now we all have those people that you know, if he starts to speak, then half an hour is gone or 1 hour is gone. But Krishna, he, in spite of the situation around Arjuna, that it was a battlefield, Krishna just patiently heard for almost 47 plus 7, and 2.10, Krishna starts to speak, Shri Bhagavan Vacha is 2.10. So 46 plus 10, 56 verses, till Arjuna said, Krishna, now you tell me. Till then, Krishna didn't speak. Kyunki jab tak advice manga nahi hai, dena kyun chahiye? There are many free advisors around us. And so so whether it be Bhagavad Gita, whether it be Srila Prabhupada's interaction with his guru, this ability to hear, this art of listening, is a very crucial factor in spiritual advancement and also in relationships. So we'll go through some of the styles of listening, how we should try to avoid them, and some of the positive ways in which we should try to listen. Else, we try to give solutions even without understanding the need or the problem. Like, you know, a shoe guy trying to give solution even before he understands what is your shoe size. Therefore, George Bernard Shaw said that, I think the only sensible guy in this world is a tailor man. Because only he takes measurements every time I go. Everybody else uses the previous measurements. That kabhi to kuch to interaction hua tha, they have a judgment or a measurement about us. And typically we tend to use that as a yardstick to convey others, rather than trying to understand that this person might have grown out of that. And now with communication, the age of internet communication, WhatsApp and other things, although it is said to be communication has increased, but miscommunication or discommunication has increased, not communication. Because whatever we try to share through the words, through those texts, not everything is fully understood, because words only carry a limited amount of information about what is the exact situation with which the person is trying to convey. So therefore, Krishna also has given us 2 ears and 1 mouth. Speak less and listen more. And there was this sadhu who gave the king 4 dolls. And he was amused that why did this sadhu give him four dolls? And he also gave him a thread. And he said that you should understand how to use this doll in different situations through this, using this thread. And then he took that thread and he put that needle or the wire into 1 ear. When he put into 1 ear, it went and it came into the other ear, through the other ear. So this is called as ISKCON se suna, USKCON se chod diya. Sometimes ISKCON is called as ISKCON. That suna lekin suna nahi. That your mind was somewhere else, so you didn't actually hear. And then the other was, there was no hole only. You are so blinded by your beliefs or what is your desires, you don't even pay attention, you don't even try to take it. You don't even come to hear the class. Then the other was that it goes in 1 ear and it goes out of the mouth. That you hear and you speak it out. But the other was, when you put in, it goes directly inside, doesn't come out. And the message was, in different situations, especially if something is of really secret or something of somebody else's life, don't just rumor it, don't just spread it around. Keep it with your heart, and when whatever is the best way you can deal with it, speak it or apply it. So people don't care how much you know until they know how much you care. Only when you know that whom can I speak to, something confidential, something important, if that person has trust, if I trust that person that and this person really cares, that whatever I am speaking, he will keep it with him and convey with that understanding or knowledge that what will be the most beneficial for me. So we don't just want to know from anyone or everyone, only from those people that actually care for us. To them, we want to hear from them. To them, we want to speak to them. So when it comes to hearing styles, there are 5 poor listening styles, 5 ways which we usually tend to hear. And I'm sure even here in the audience, there were many of us, when we are hearing the Bhagavad Gita or Bhagavatam classes or the Sunday feast, we might be going through one of these poor listening styles. One is called as spacing out. Spacing out means you are there, but you are not there, like the first doll. Ye kaan se ja raha hai, lekin dusre kaan se ja. You are not paying attention there. So therefore, there was no impact or use of that content in your life. Once a priest and a taxi driver had gone to heaven or Yamaraj. And then their whole account was tallied, and then the final bill came or where they should be placed. And then the priest was placed into Yamalok, and the taxi driver was placed into heavenly planet, Swargalok. So the priest immediately raised objection. Come on, I know this taxi driver. He never practiced any kind of religion or anything. Whereas me, every Sunday, I used to give so many talks, different places, and there were so many people that were hearing me. I was serving God in so many ways. How is it that when for me you are sending me to hell and for him you are sending him to heaven? So I think Chitra Gupta or whoever is the head of that place, he said, see, we only see the impact that you had and the taxi driver had on the society. Whenever you are speaking, people are all dozing. So nobody actually heard whatever you spoke. It was just going through. You didn't help people remember God. Whereas this taxi guy, he was such a rash driver. The moment somebody sat in his taxi, people were constantly remembering God. So according to us, he made more people remember God than all your talks. So therefore, he gets to go to heaven and you go to hell. Of course, just a story to make a point. But either the speaker is not really giving something that is relevant, or the audience is not really taking it, is spacing out. So then, once in a while, you drop in. So this is called as spacing out type of listening. Another is to pretend listening. That you kind of pretend as if you are very attentive to that person who is speaking to you. This many times happens at home with our parents. That you are interested in some mobile stuff and the mama or the papa is speaking to you. And you kind of saying, how do you pretend? You say, huh. And especially if it's a phone call, then the pretend is even more relaxed. All you have to keep saying is catch some word and say, okay, is it like that? Or you just say, huh. And then easily that 1 hour call or half an hour call is gone in pretense. So they say it takes patience to listen, but it also takes skill to pretend. And somehow we have more skill to pretend than patience to listen. And Arjuna also didn't pretend. Arjuna was very alert there. And whenever there was a doubt that he had, immediately he asked a question. Even in the Srimad Bhagavatam, Shukadeva Goswami, as he was narrating, Parikshit was so alert that if somebody was just, you know, pretending to listen, he could have missed that point. But Shukadeva Goswami, as soon as he speaks something, Parikshit immediately stops him. So you said this, but how can this happen? Because Krishna was at the age of 5, he was with his coward boys when Brahma Vimohan Lila, when the Aghasur pastime happened. But you said Brahma Vimohan Lila, the ending of it happened at the age of 6. The conclusion when every... So the narration of that, the Gopas, when they come home, they start to speak how Krishna killed Aghasur after 1 year. So immediately Parikshit catches that because he was not pretending. So these are different words that people use when they pretending to listen. Another is called as selective listening. As you can see in the image there, that as soon as wife starts to speak, it's off, and TV it's on. So they say TV may on, BV may off. that you select whom to listen. And this is also there that we tend to hear the jokes in the class. For that we become very attentive. And as soon as philosophy comes, we become, अरे ये तो सुना हुआ ही है. It recently happened. We were watching a drama. It was in some of the devotees in Surat had done dramas, different drama festivals. I was also there. So they did this drama called as Kabir Singh Returns. All of you know Kabir Singh was a popular movie a year back. So a lot of youth had come. Seeing Kabir Singh Returns seems to be a very interesting topic for the drama. And to keep it complete, they showed the first phase of Kabir Singh, where he was an aggressive man, he falls in love, but then he's not able to control his anger. And then he meets a devotee. And I saw literally, as soon as he meets a devotee, so many of these youth started to leave the hall. Because abhi tak kya chal raha tha? Aggression chal raha tha, romance chal raha tha. But now they are choosing to not hear the next part, that how can his life be more complete than before. So this is selective listening. Like here in this thing, the wife is saying, go to the store, lay down the mulch. Mulch is some kind of material. Wash and wax the car. She's giving task list for the day. Get the kids at school, rent some videos, and finish the rest of the dishes. I don't know who can give so many orders, but when the wife says this, what is selective listening? Selective listening is go, lay down, and get some rest. Go was from the go to the store. From that only go was heard. Lay down the mulch, put something to dry under the sun. So only lay down was heard. Wash and wax the car. Of course, that was not heard at all. Get the kids to the school. Only get was heard. Rent some videos. Again, other things were not heard. Finish the rest of the dishes. So only rest. So this is called as selective listening. Another is word listening. Word listening is where we don't understand the feelings or the context in which that particular thing is being spoken. Only the words are paid attention to. Once a mother had gone with her son to a store. And in the store, as she was buying things for the home, he saw that the son was eyeing on one of the neighboring girls who was also come. So when they came back, so the mother asked the son, beta, what do you think about Preeti? That girl's name was Preeti. And the boy said, Preeti, what do I think about her? Nothing. Now, what do you think about her? Says, she's a good student. She is this, or she has surname like this. But when the mother asked that question, what do you think about Preeti? It was within a context that you are looking at her constantly. Or it may also happen with husband and wife, that the husband seems to have some other relationship. So the wife asks, what do you think about this particular lady in our locality? Now, if you only focus on the word, then you are in trouble. You may glorify that person and trouble will increase. So this is called as word listening. Only to the words, but not to the feelings or the true meaning behind why that is being spoken. So whenever somebody says something, I'm not happy, you could just say, why are you not happy?
this is there, that is there. But the feeling that he is having, not happy, that word has some feeling behind it. And if you don't understand the feeling and just focus on the words, often this also happens that in any argument, people catch the words and they make a even bigger issue out of it. That you use this particular word, it might have come out of some kind of anger, but usually it is cornered. If you use this word, that means that there was something in your mind that made you blurt out this word. And all of this is usually because of this fifth type of listening that is called as self-centered listening, where even although you are hearing, you are only seeing from your perspective everyone else's life. Somebody is crying because he didn't get marks or something. But because you're not going through that issue, you typically kind of, "Arre, mera dekho, halat kya hai?" And this story is there that in the France, when there was famine, the queen was approached that there is no food for our citizens. There is no bread in the whole state to feed them. And the queen said, if there is no bread in the state, then feed everybody cake. Sabko agar bread nahi to cake khila do. But cake comes from bread only. If you just add some sugar, that's what becomes cake. But because she was so satisfied with her, all the luxuries that she was in, she never understood what is the other person going through. So if you have to really listen, then we have to keep the other person's perspective and with that try to listen. But as long as we try to listen with our perspective, when Arjuna told Krishna, "Krishna, this mind is too difficult to be conquered." Krishna doesn't say this, that for me mind is not a problem. Krishna accepts Arjuna's predicament because he is understanding the situation of a conditioned soul, although he is transcendental. But we many times act transcendental to other people's issues when they speak, because we are many times self-centered listening. And in this, there is often the need of the human heart to be understood is not fulfilled, because these five poor listening styles don't allow us to fully understand either the content that is spoken in a class or the discussion that is had between two people. So in the scriptures, there are four types of listeners that are recommended. That if you want to listen, you have to be cultivating these four qualities, then you will be able to better listen. Else those poor listening styles will continue and you will misunderstand people because you are spaced out, or people will misunderstand you. You wanted something, but then they come out with something else as a solution, or they share something else in the world outside. And many a times, just this aspect of listening solves so many people's problems, because somebody has heard and just understood that, yes, the situation you are going through is tough, and I understand. I may not say that you stay in that situation, but at least I understand that situation. And many people go into depression because of this main reason, that they feel that nobody understands them, including their parents. Because many times, self-centered listening, whatever is being spoken, we kind of go back to our generation. Say, "Hamare generation mein toh hum aisa the." And then that's right, it's not wrong. But from that person's perspective, is it something that he can understand? So that there is misunderstanding in both sides. So the so in the scriptures, there is description about four types of listeners, or qualities that we need to cultivate. the favorable listener is the first one. They are all different birds, different animals that is compared to. So it is more easier to remember. Scriptures are amazing. They give us very visual tools to for something so subtle, this art of listening. So the first is the Chataka bird. This Chataka bird we may not find nowadays. We don't find except crows and pigeons in Bombay. So parrots also somewhere else, or if you go to Baikala Zoo, we may find more birds there. But other than that, so Chataka is a very special bird that only drinks water that is coming directly from the sky, from the clouds. And this conveys a principle in listening is that Chataka first focuses on the Chataka type of listening is what is the source from where you are listening. Because if the source is not pure, then the information that you get from that may be very, very much wrong. And nowadays we tend to believe everything that is uploaded on the internet. Any YouTube video that may come sharing something, some information about someone or some situation, then we tend to believe that. But first aspect of listening is the source proper? From where you are listening, is the source authorized or is it pure? This, in 1958, when China became the People's Republic of China, the first chief there, Mao Zedong, he wanted to really pump up the economy of China. And to pump up the economy of China, he surveyed what is it that is stopping our economy to grow. It was mainly not electronic, but an agricultural base like India. There was not much technology then. So they came up with that, the scientists and the researchers, that there are four pests that are spoiling our crops, our produce. And if we can eradicate these four pests, our produce, our grains that are there will multiply 4 to 5 times, and we can export so much and there will be so much growth. And these four pests were, one was rats, another was mosquitoes, they cause malaria, farmers get sick. Another was, this sparrows. And the other one was another type of insect that was causing harm to the harvest in the fields. So this immediately started to kill all of them. But how can you kill sparrows? Because they are always flying. So they came up with that you cannot kill sparrow, but you can make them exhausted, or you can make them run away from the whole country of China. And birds are very sensitive to vibrations. So they found out that there is this particular drum. When you beat that, the sparrows cannot stay there. They have to fly away. So they ordered these drums to be beaten all over China. And the sparrows had to literally fly, fly, fly till they dropped dead or till they escaped the country. And that way, almost within 2-3 months in 1958, the whole country of China didn't had any sparrows, sparrow free. Because sparrows used to get the grains, a lot of grains. So naturally that year, the harvest was 3 times more than usual. And everybody praised the newly elected communist chief that, see, here he is thinking of our welfare. But the next year, the produce dropped to even half of what was there previously. This time it was 4 times. Now it became half of what was coming before. And then the scientists again did research. What happened? And then they found out that the farms were infested with locust pests, a kind of, you know, or insects that were being eaten by the sparrows. And now there were no sparrows in the whole country of China. There was no stoppage to the locusts. And the locusts just increased like anything, and they were devouring all the farms in the country. Now what to do? Now kill all the locusts. But then, how many will you kill? But even if you kill, the people are still hungry. People don't have food to eat. And that's when it was greatly promoted that eat anything that you can, especially the locusts, that all types of insects are edible. There was a big propaganda that it doesn't harm health, they can be eaten. So that's how in China, the whole habit of eating anything that flies except a helicopter or an aeroplane started. Eating anything that moves except an automobile was encouraged. So this is when you gain information from a source that is not fully cognizant of the reality. That kind of information, that kind of listening leads to more damage. And then now we know the situation that is there. That habit led to another greater disaster, which the whole world is somehow trying to understand, how can we come out of this? How can we stop this? But it all started with going against the nature of the sparrows are eating our grains. Stop them from eating. So when it comes to information or hearing, the scriptures say that human beings are all susceptible to 4 defects. Therefore, any information, any knowledge that a human being tends to share will always be imperfect. And therefore, the Vedas or the Bhagavad Gita are called as apaurusheya. The books or the information, that knowledge that is not human originated. Purusha means human and apurusha means beyond human, that is coming from another realm. And the reason why we cannot trust any information that is a human being collects in this world, the 4 things which those of you have attended enough of Bhagavad Gita classes in the temple might have heard this, but in this perspective I'd like to share. One is that human beings or living entities have defective or imperfect senses. We cannot see everything that is happening in front of us. We can only see 1% of the reality that is in front of us, because the visible range is only 1% of the whole light spectrum that is there. There is so much more here. There is so much more inside the body. But you can't see. You need scanners, MRI, you need X-ray to be able to see that. And whenever we make conclusions, either in our day-to-day living, either about God or about the world, just based on our senses, what we have seen, then understand that you're going to get into trouble. So because we have imperfect senses, we tend to be illusioned. We don't really grasp what is the reality, and we make a wrong conception about people around us, about situations, about life, about the world. And then once we are illusioned, we make mistakes. गलतियाँ करते हैं, लगता है कि यहाँ पे है, but actually it is here because you were illusioned. And when you make mistakes because of your imperfect senses, you usually, because the ego is there, instead of clarifying that I am sorry or I made a mistake, there is a tendency to cheat. How can I cover up my mistake? Galti ho gaya abhi. Now, I don't want that to be revealed to the public. How can I cover up that? And because of this, four weaknesses or imperfections that human beings have, anything that we tend to infer in this world will always be imperfect. But just like the Chataka always only seeks water from the purest of sources, that is the cloud, same way we should just not trust, first of all, internet, that okay, even about ISKCON or about any particular devotee or any particular thing, anything you type, enough you get. If something is really famous, there will be equally infamous things about that thing on the internet. Sometimes out of jealousy, sometimes out of misunderstanding. And so that is one thing, don't trust the information that is there, even if it is Wikipedia. Always verify that with, especially if it is about Bhagavad Gita or it is about something about someone, best is to ask that person or clarify with that person. And this understanding that the source of my information from where I am listening, because it is imperfect, let me not make conclusions or judgments based on this. There may be other side to the story, there may be other perspectives to the story, and seeing is not believing. And science try to understand that how does we make a conclusion in our life. When we try to make a conclusion in our life, it is based on the culture from where we are coming and the assumptions that we have and also what we see. So there is the observable data and experiences, what we see around us. But based on what we see, what we select some data that we, from the everything that we observe. Right here, there are many things that we can notice. There is the Lord, there is the PowerPoint, there is me, there are so many other devotees. And sometimes this is one of the habits, that when we are sitting in the class, we are seeing what others are doing. Oh, kaisa so raha hai, oh, mobile pe kaisa text kar raha hai, rather than. We can always select what data we want to focus, because neither our eyes can see everything at the same time, neither can our brain process everything that is happening. So it also tends to just focus on one program, like a computer. So first of all, we select the data. So sometimes, you know, there is a lot of music being played, there is a noise, traffic noise and different thing. But some of us, if you select, we can just hear that as the main thing. And other things don't matter much. From the data that we select to observe, based on the cultural and personal meaning we have with that, we tend to make a sense of that. Gaurampu tells this story that there was a Westerner who came to a South Indian hotel, Udipi restaurant. And when he was going out, the owner asked him, how was the meal? So the meal was very good, but the salad was a bit hard. Because he had also eaten the banana leaf. Because in the Western tradition, they serve you in a plate. But in India, what happens, especially some hoodipi hotels, there is a plate, but on top of the plate, there is a banana leaf. And on that, there is rice, different things that is served. So he saw that data, but based on the culture from where he is coming, he thought, okay, maybe this is something to eat because it's on the plate. And what assumptions influence the meaning of that? And then based on the assumptions, we make conclusions. And based on the conclusions, we make our beliefs. And our beliefs again drive what we select. So the research says that it is our belief actually make us to see rather than our seeing makes us to believe. So if you trust a person, you'll see that person according to that trust. If you mistrust a person according to that belief, you'll see that person. Same with the reality around us. If you believe in God, you will see God's presence everywhere, like Prahlad. But if you don't believe in God, even if when God comes like Narasimha Dev, he said, this is just a half man, half lion. Where is God? He didn't see. So therefore, scriptures, first of all, try to strengthen our belief system, our values, based on that purest source of information, that is the Vedas. And why we believe in this? This is a temple in Kerala, recently became very famous for one particular thing, Kundadam Vadukkana temple in Thrissur. Here on the walls, how the embryo in the womb develops is carved. We always say that, you know, in the Srimad Bhagavatam, the whole sonography, how the embryo develops is given, because it is like the cloud. It is the purest information that we can seek. So when we are hearing Srimad Bhagavatam or the Gita, we are not just hearing any human beings, Anko Dekha Hal, or anyone's, you know, speculation or understanding about that. We are trying to take it from the cloud. And not just, so in the Bhagavad Gita, there are so many sciences also that are given. And Gita is also like a life's manual, where for all the problems, there is spiritual solutions that are there. So because of this, we have to trust that the source that where we are listening from in spiritual growth is from the proper source. And just like the cloud, it originates from the ocean. Same way, the Vedas originate from the Krishna. Hey Krishna Karuna Sindhu. Krishna is a ocean of mercy. And the Vedas, Dharma Su Sakshat Bhagavat Pranitam, they have originated from the Vedas. But who will bring them to us? The spiritual master is also compared to a cloud. We sing every day in the morning. Samsara Dava Nalalida Loka Tranaya Karunya Ghana Ganatvam. That the spiritual master, he takes the mercy of Krishna in the form of his instructions in the Vedas, and he brings it to different conditioned souls. Because although we are close to the ocean, not all India is close to the ocean. So the clouds go to different parts of the country and share that mercy, that water that is there in the ocean. Same way the spiritual master, the devotees, they are like that cloud that take the water and go and share. And they share to relieve us from the material problems that we are facing. So therefore, this is the first criteria, first type of proper listener, is that he always verifies the source when it comes to spiritual knowledge. And it comes to your day-to-day affairs, somebody speaks something, many things are rumors, just somebody's guess, but verify the source. The second type of favorable listener is called as a Hamsa. Hamsa has this amazing quality that it can separate milk from water. Agar pani aur doodh milaya hua hai, to doodh ka doodh pani ka pani kar deta hai. We have this phrase, but it comes from Hamsa. Hamsa has that quality. So therefore, if you have a Hamsa in your home, milkman cannot cheat you. But we cannot have Hamsas because there is no lakes in our localities. So Hamsa, it seeks only the essence and it separates that which is not needed, that which is not actually of worth. Same way, when we are hearing, even in the Vedas, even in the scriptures, the many things that are spoken, but there is a one thing that is the focus, the one thing that is the essence. And when a person is speaking, the one who is listening, you should always try to seek what is the essential message that he is trying to give through this. What is the principle and what is the detail? Even in the Puranas, there are so many paths that are spoken about. Even Bhagavad Gita has around 30 types of yogas that are mentioned. And you can say, we only speak about bhakti yoga. Because whenever Krishna mentions any type of yoga, it is in comparison to how bhakti yoga is better. Or what is the stage at which a person practices this type of yoga. Just like, when you try to buy a mobile, there is comparison chart. Compared to this mobile, all these others stand here. But if somebody just sees, so many mobiles are being mentioned, and just thinks, all mobiles are same, which is wrong. So a Hamsa-like type of listener, he focuses on the essence. What is the essential message? Like in the Gita, from start to end, there's Arjuna speaks, then Sanjaya speaks, Dhritarashtra speaks, Duryodhana speaks, and Krishna speaks. And even Krishna's message, as I said, there are so many chapters. But what is the essential message? Of course, if we are connected to the proper source, they will help us to find that ability to grasp the essence and not be deviated by all the details that are there. So always seek the essence in that. With every message, every conversation has a driving point, that there is some kind of message that is wants to convey. So a proper listener always tries to go to the essence rather than just get it. Many times happens that people tend to remember the jokes in a class or some story in a class and forget the main point of the class. So that is that kind of selective listening or word listening. But if you are like a swan type of listener, then there was that story, there was that joke, but the main thing was the essence that, yes, we need to always verify the source. The third type of listener, favorable listener, is compared to a parrot. Parrot has this quality of that if you speak to it, if you train it properly, it will repeat. Now, whenever I heard this, that sunne mein aur bolne mein connection kya, if you can repeat. But then lately I came across that when you are able to repeat what is being spoken, then you have heard it properly. Or if the intention is that you want to speak, you want to repeat it, either to yourself or to somebody else, then there is greater absorption or retention of what we listened. So there is one aspect is that you just hear. Another is you make kind of notes. So in the learning pyramid, when this comes that when somebody attends a lecture, only 5% of what they heard retains with them. But if they read or, you know, write what they are hearing, then there is 10% retention. But if there is audio visuals and they try to visualize what is being spoken, then there is 20% more retention. If there is a demonstration, किसी को यहाँ पे ड्रामा कराते, how to not hear, then that is even more better. Not just demonstration, discussion, that involve that person who is listening in what is being spoken there, then there is greater. Then practice by doing, not just discuss, go and do that. You hear about say gardening, go and do it. And the highest is when you teach others. 90% of the retention or is when you try to share what you heard with somebody else. It need not be a big audience. You heard today, when you go home, jo bhi suna, try to share. Because when you try to share, then that listening becomes most effective. So therefore, parrot type of listening means that I want to listen in such a way that I should be able to repeat it. If not verbatim, as much as possible. Therefore, the one of the reasons why devotees become preachers is so that we can become jo bhi bol rahe ho, we are the first ones who will remember it the most because we have to speak. Now that you have to speak, you have to really understand the concept. Hearing, you can pretend. You can, space out. But speaking, you cannot space out. You cannot pretend that you are speaking something, but you really don't understand it. And when it comes to somebody else, say somebody is speaking to you something. And when somebody else is speaking to you, this parrot type of listening, how can it be applied there? In one-to-one conversations, is that after that person has spoken to you, speak to that person what he spoke to you. May not be everything, right? It's not that you tape record it and speak it. You have to reflect the feeling that that person carried when he was speaking. He might be speaking with some kind of, disappointment or with some kind of joy, some kind of surprise. You didn't get it. He spoke with joy and you are speaking with sadness. So the feeling that the person was carrying when he was speaking has to be there. And rephrase the content. Brajbhaiya Ripu, he mentions these two points. That he has spoken something to you. Change the words and speak it back to him. And if he agrees, then that person is so happy that somebody has really understood what I meant. Otherwise, many times what happens? That you hear, wo devotee bolta, Prabhu ji, samjhe na aap. Aap kya bolte? Samajh gaya main. Lekin wo puch, most probably wo puchte nahi hai out of etiquette. Prabhu ji, kya samjhe, thoda batayenge kya? So usually what is the typical reply? Achha, phir se ek bar batao kya, kya bola tha tumne? So rephrase the content. So listening is a very responsible activity. But if you can rephrase the content and reflect the feeling, then that is like parrot type of listening where you are able to repeat. The fourth type of favorable listener is compared to fish. Why fish? Because fish always lives in water. As soon as you take it out of water, it starts to die. Same way, as spiritual seeker, you should always live in that message, that spiritual message that is there. He never takes himself out of that message that has been given to him. If not, it's not that abhi bahar gaye, so you are not reflecting, or that is no more alive. Another quality of the fish is that the fish doesn't have eyelids, or it has transparent eyelids. So kabhi aankh band nahi karta hai, kyunki it is always has to survive from other predators. So as soon as eyes close, the other fish become, you don't know where, from where the enemy is coming. So the fish always has its eyes open. So a physical aspect of hearing is to keep the eyes open when listening. If you are sun raha hu main. Usually when we close our eyes, our mind tends to think, now outside data is, stimulus is gone, then it starts to roam, or the other thing is that you start to doze off. One devotee says that devotees usually keep their iPods in front of you and then they close their eyelids. Wo so jate. Or as Gaurampu says, Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudeva, eyes are closed, Mahaprasade Govinde, eyes get open. So when I speak to anyone, especially my mother, if I am not looking at her, then she doubts. She asks me, are you listening? Because looking is a very sure sign of listening. If you're not looking, then maybe you're not also listening. So fish represents alertness. And whatever it takes for us to be most alert, we have to be. Like if you're coming for a Bhagavatam class or Sunday Feast class, then don't try to make your schedule so packed that the moment you land yourself in an AC hall, then you doze off for the whole flight journey. And when the announcer or the air host makes the announcement, we have reached, then you open the eyes. So keep your physical self, your mental self, not so taxed that you can actually focus. And therefore, the environment in which we hear also matters a lot when we hear. And therefore, this particular hall, His Holiness Radhanath Maharaj wanted it, made it to be a AC hall, so that the aspect of listening without any kind of, you know, disturbance to the body of sweat or other things is not there. So there is total concentration, ability to concentrate. In the typical Vedic styles, almost all satsangs used to happen in natural settings. Shukadev Goswami spoke to Parikshit Maharaj next to a river. Or Gurukuls used to be under different trees. And now most of the listening environment is kind of, you know, this kind of classrooms where everything is so static. And the background makes a lot of effect on the receiver, on the one who is listening, because the teacher is only moving. The mind has a natural tendency to focus on something that is moving rather than something that is not moving. But so when there is a motion, usually then there is more attention. But that motion shouldn't be so much. Nowadays you see earlier news reporters, Aaj Tak or DD News, they used to come with पीछे कुछ नहीं है, कुछ तो ऐसा एक उनका लोगो है, एंड वेरी ब्लैंड काइंड ऑफ थिंग. नाउडेज इफ यू सी द रिपोर्टर के पीछे पूरा ऑफिस दिख रहा है, समबडी इज मूविंग. एंड द रीजन इज दैट वी टेंड टू गेट डिस्ट्रैक्टेड, बट इफ यू गेट डिस्ट्रैक्टेड विद इन दैट फ्रेम, देन वी वॉन्ट गेट डिस्ट्रैक्टेड आउटसाइड दैट फ्रेम. So same way with the nature, if you are sitting in under a tree, the tree is not static. Tree, something is moving. Patta hil raha hai, there is a bird. So that aspect, that focus is there as long as there is some kind of motion. So therefore, videos catch our attention more than just text. So these are the four types of favorable listeners. Chataka, verify the source, swan, find the essence, don't get diverted into the details. Parrot, repetition is the best way of listening. Fish, be alert. Now quickly, we don't have much time left about wrong types of listeners, but we'll cover them. These are ways in which we shouldn't listen. One is called as a wolf or a fox type of listener, where there is some kind of motivation in that person listening. This story comes in Tukaram Maharaj. One day he was sitting and speaking Krishna Lila. And it was late in the night, he was so absorbed. Gradually, one by one, all villagers started to move out. They went and slept. So in the late night, when Tukaram Maharaj opened his eyes, there was only one person who was still sitting. And Tukaram Maharaj became so happy. Kitna eager listener hai aap. Ki sab log chale gaye, lekin aap akela baithe. And that man said, no, Swamiji, jo kambal pe aap baithe na, wo mera kambal hai. So I'm waiting when you will stop your katha so that I can take my kambal. So he's sitting in the class, but there is a motivation. People should know that I'm sitting in the class. Or some other thing that, okay, I can get connected to somebody who can take me abroad. Or whatever, I can make business contacts. So when there is a motivated type of, that is kind of a wolf. Wolf is commonly in Panchatantra. So always that has some self-interest, that is there, something that is selfish in its perspective. Another kind of listener that is represents wolf is somebody who disturbs the class. That class is going on, suddenly he raises something else or he tries to seek attention, just like a wolf. Suddenly it starts to howl. So without disturbing, whenever there is that channel is opened up, that time the audience discusses. Another wrong type of listener is compared to a bee. A bee collects honey from so many flowers only to deposit or give it to some. It's its duty, or it is taking it, but it is not applying it, it's not relishing it. So that honey, as I said, to speak to others with the intent to speak to others to hear is good, but with the intent to speak to others without an intent to apply on oneself is like a bee. Bahut bar hota hai class mein, are inka class mein baithenge to bahut sara points milega preaching ke liye. So let me hear from this so that I can speak well, or I can repeat this somewhere else. So when we collect the honey to impress some or use that somewhere else to someone else, so it is compared to a honeybee, where the honeybee is struggling hard to collect the nectar, but it never relishes that honey, it goes and deposits, and then queen bee or the one who collects the honey, he has all the nectar. So that is a wrong type, where there is no self-application, there is only, it is used as a profession or as a tool for some other motive. Third type of wrong listener is called as a bull. Now bull, all respects to bull, bull represents dharma. And often when people say that gold setting, they say hit the bull's eye. I always say, why do you use that? Why we shouldn't use that language? Bull ka eye ko kyun maarne ka? Because bull's eye, bull is sacred. But in shastras, no person, no gender, no species, no position is either purely condemned or purely glorified. Whether it be a brahmana, whether it be a woman, whether it be a brahmachari, whether it be a sannyasi, whether it be a demigod, whether it be a asura, there is a good and there is a bad. And one has to see both and take focus on the good and try to minimize the bad. Same way, one of the bad qualities of the bull is that it has an idiosyncrasy. And the idiosyncrasy of the bull is that hamesha mundi hilata. You've seen a bull? Always. So we have some types of listeners. Aap jo bhi bolenge, aapke saamne bolenge, karenge? Haan, Prabhu ji karenge. Lekin baad mein kya hoga? Somebody has his mobile on. बाद में क्या होगा जैसे ही जाएंगे बाहर दे फॉरगेट दैट दे फॉरगेट सो हुमेवर दे गो इन फ्रंट ऑफ व्हाट एवर दे से देल यस प्रभु जी करेंगे कल के दिन दे गो टू सम मूवी एंड देर समथिंग एल्स प्रोपगेटेड व्हाट इज नॉट अकॉर्डिंग टू प्रिंसिपल्स ऑफ धर्म बोलेंगे दिस इज ऑल्सो गुड. So they tend to just fill their belly. That is their main task. Somehow we have to fill our time. Whatever entertains us, it is fine. Whether it be spirituality or materialism or anything. Our whole goal is that we want to fill our time with some good fun, good entertainment. So this is also wrong type of listening. The main priority is to nourish ourselves. Some foods have taste, some don't have. But whenever it is served, because it is done with proper understanding, that should be taken. So this also should be avoided. Bull, whatever it ghas diya, kuch bhi diya, everything it just keeps taking, doesn't discriminate what should be taken, what should not be taken. The last type of wrong listener is compared to a camel. Camel, when in the deserts, when it eats thorns, it finds the thorns very tasty, not because the thorns have any taste in them, but the thorns cut the tongue of the camel, and that when the blood comes out of the tongue and it goes on the other parts of the tongue which is still fine, the blood appears to be sweet. Even some of us, when we had a cut, we put our thing, it appears to be sweet or at least non-tasty. And it's good in the sense that saliva is antiseptic, it will heal that wound faster. May not be when you're doing Brahminical activities of cleanliness, but other times it's a natural instinct to stop that blood flow. But this camel, it starts to feel that this thorn is so tasty and tries to eat more, although that thorn is worsening the situation of the tongue. Same way, there are some listeners, when they listen from a wrong source, they are actually conveying something that is like a thorn, something that is going to harm them. But because it appears to be presented in a very attractive way, and what is that blood? That blood may be some kind of need they have, some kind of music or very good charismatic words or the presentation, but the whole content is something so harmful. Or some speakers tend to glorify the wrong characters in the scriptures. Ravana is glorified, or Duryodhana is glorified, or Karna is glorified. And then this kind of audience feel, oh, so nice. But those mentalities, actually, if you start to apply it, they're going to harm you. So these are camel type of listeners. Jisme ruchi lena chahiye, usme ruchi nahi lete. And those things that are, people always have objections. Why did Krishna or why did Ram kill Vali like this. Without understanding, of course, the full context, there are so many seminars that devotees have about controversies in the scriptures. So the camel represents the lower taste, where the taste that which we are supposed to be condemned, those tastes when they are presented in a Bhagavatam or in satsangs, they are appreciated and people tend to throng for that, although they are the ones which is self-defeating, or they are troubling, they are going to trouble that person more rather than connect to the higher self. So these are the four types of wrong types of listening. So when Arjuna heard the Bhagavad Gita, it was with full understanding that Krishna is the purest, he has the best intention, he is the supreme Lord, so therefore he is like that cloud, he is going to give me. And Arjuna asked Krishna that, I want to know what is the highest, best, good for me, Shreya. He was like the swan. I want to only take the essence, what is the most important thing. And like the like the fish, he was alert. And then the third thing, what was the third thing? The favorable listeners, he was like the parrot. He executed Krishna's instructions. Of course, later he might have gone, but when Krishna spoke, Prabhupada writes in the 10th chapter that Arjuna starts to glorify Krishna as the Parandama, that Pavitram Purusham Paramam. So Prabhupada says that Arjuna perfectly understood what Krishna was trying to convey, and both sides. I'll just take two verses where Krishna says that only because of ahankar we often tend to think that it is me who is the doer of the activities, then we suffer. But when we hear the scriptures, that we properly listen, then we start to understand this ahankara is the cause of all my troubles, then how I can overcome that. And this verse, one of the last verses that Krishna speaks, he speaks about, if you hear from me, what will happen? Machitta sarva durgani, you can chant. Machitta sarva durgani, mat prasada tarishyasi, atachetvam ahankaran, nashrosyasi vinangshasi. If you become conscious of me, you will pass over all the obstacles of conditioned life by my grace. If, however, you do not work in such consciousness but act through false ego, not hearing me, you will be lost. So if you don't hear Krishna, if you don't listen, cultivate this proper qualities of listening, then you will be lost. And even the beginning of the 7th chapter, one of the most lectured verse from the Bhagavad Gita by Prabhupada was this 7.1, which gives the effects of hearing. But Krishna says, Tashrunu, that once when you hear from me, then you become free from all doubt, then your mind will become attached to me, then you will become fixed in your yoga, in your meditation upon me. So this way, there are great benefits spiritually when we hear from the proper source, but also in our day-to-day life, many of the troubles happen because we don't cultivate this essential quality of to listen. And so I just wanted to share this so we all become good listeners, because spiritual path, bhakti starts with shravanam. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. So we would like to thank Braj Mohan Prabhu for enlightening us on the various aspects of the most important thing, Shravanam, about listening, as he concluded, and also detailing us many aspects which were most of us were unaware. Now he has enlightened all of us, and I hope we all have listened to it with great attention. So we would like to thank him by loudly chanting 3 times. Hari Bol, Hari Bol, Hari Bol. Also, First of all, we would like to welcome those guests who have come to our Sunday Feast program for the very first time. सबसे पहले हम सभी भक्तों का और अतिथियों का स्वागत करना चाहेंगे जो पहली बार हमारे इस संडे फीस्ट कार्यक्रम में आए हैं. तो कृपया करके अपने अपने स्थानों में खड़े हो जाएं. प्लीज स्टैंड अप एट योर रेस्पेक्टिव प्लेसेस. इट्स थैंक यू वेरी मच. इट्स वेरी एनकरेजिंग टू सी सो मेनी पीपल हु हैव कम. सो इफ यू वुड लाइक टू receive a small token of gift of appreciation, we have our guest reception team devotees waiting behind near Hanumanji. So we would request you all to meet with them, and they would share with you the Mahaprasadam as well as a token gift of appreciation. And if you have any questions regarding Krishna consciousness in general as well as the temple's activities in particular, he will be very happy to share with you all the answer your questions. So hamare swagat adhyaksh shriman us hanuman ji ke vigrah ke paas mein khade hain. To aap sabhi ko radha gopinath ji ke mahaprasad ke sath swagat bhi karenge, aur sath hi sath aapke kuch agar prashn ho is mandir ke karyakram ke bare mein to uska bhi wo jawab denge. To kripya unse bhent kijiyega. So we would like to request those who have come for the first time, and we would like to welcome you all by loudly chanting three times
Hari Bol, Hari Bol, Hari Bol.
And also we would like to pray to at the lotus feet of Shri Radha Gopinath that you keep coming regularly, and may this be an auspicious beginning in your Krishna consciousness life.
Thank you.
So hum Shri Radha Gopinath ji se prarthana karte hain ki ye aapke Krishna bhavanamrit karyakram ka shubharambh thehre. So now we will have after that we'll have kirtan right now, and after that everybody can go down and have prasad. Hare Krishna. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Acha.